why I said the only way I'm gonna get stuck in a contract is if you paying me.
Right. I mean, if it's a good,
if you paying me, yeah. But then again, as an artist, you want to be able free to do stuff. So but, you know, who wants to be stuck?
Yeah, I mean, if you're trying to pay me to be stuck with millions of dollars, I mean, right? Maybe, depends how much. Maybe you're being stuck isn't that bad.
Right. It ain't that bad. I just gotta wait 3 to 5 years.
Convincing Creatives. This is episode 15. We have special guest on the show. We got Johnny Dutch. So Johnny and I kind of know each other pretty well, right? Would you say?
I think by now, yeah.
Yeah, by now. So if you don't know, I've actually been making a documentary about Johnny for the last 5 years called Run of the Picture. Right when you're listening or watching this podcast, it's probably on Amazon Prime, so you should go watch it. But that's kind of how we met. Like, we met back in 2014. I read an article in the News and Observer, of all places, which is the newspaper here in Raleigh, and basically just talking about making films and running track.
Yeah.
Is that like, is that probably like a good summation of what your life is? Like,
yeah, pretty much. that's how you had hit me up
right
one day. It was like, hey, I read your article. Yeah. I want to shoot your story. I was like, okay, let's go for it.
Yeah, and we just like basically met at a Starbucks and we're like, okay, so if we're going to do this, I'm just going to get some footage from one of your zombie movies, which you were making at the time, and then like some footage on the track. I was like, you know, we'll see how it goes. Maybe a couple months of filming. And then we went all the way through to the 2016 Olympic trials. We went through to making another film. We went through to you training for 4 or 5 of those years.
Yeah.
And like, we finally collected all the footage and we just watched the rough cut.
Yeah.
What was that like for you, man? Like,
it was amazing. I think you did an incredible job just to accumulate all that footage from like 4 or 5 years. Yes. I mean, let alone working on a feature for 3 months and having to puzzle that stuff together, but having to put 5 years worth of footage together, that takes some work, man. I give it to you. My hat's off to you, man.
It was just like hard drives on hard drives on hard drives.
Yeah.
Like, I probably
went like through 5 hard drives.
Yes, like probably 15 terabytes between everything. I mean, it was an insane amount of footage.
Gosh, that's a lot.
But that's the thing with doc and like documentaries is like you're just rolling and like trying to wait for a moment, and you don't want to not be rolling in case you miss it, because you know it's that moment where you're like, I think I'm good, that you're going to miss, you know, some amazing moment.
That's true.
So that was the film, and we'll come back around to Run of the Picture, but just sort of like to give people who maybe aren't aware who you are a little bit of an intro. Yeah. Who are you, Johnny? Like, what's your kind of background? Like, where'd you grow up? What's like you that makes you you?
Well, yeah, I'm originally from Raleigh, North Carolina. I grew up there and then moved to Clayton.
Okay.
Where I am now. I've traveled all over the world, and track and field has afforded me that opportunity. I've been running for Team USA since I've been in high school. I've competed for junior international teams up to senior international teams, and also the 2015 World Championships in Beijing, China. So those are the biggest platforms I've ever competed on. And then I've been to Olympic trials since 2008, right. going into 2020. Right. So that's familiar territory. Yeah. And then as far as film, I've been creating film since I was a teenager, and graduated from the University of South Carolina with a film degree.
Okay.
And since then, I've been grinding and putting out independent material.
Right. And I mean, I can only relate to that. I mean, y'all who listen know all the stuff I talk about all the time with being an independent filmmaker, but let's get Johnny's take. Johnny, like, what's that like? I mean, you know, the long days, the long hours, not having money, you know, asking for favors. Like, you know, you've been doing it for years and years and years, and also running as an international track star and like traveling across the world. Like, how do you balance the time?
Man, it's like, hard. Is there?
Like, hats off.
I still feel like there's no time.
Right. No, there never's time.
Right. It's like, never ever. Time. I feel like you just have to create time. Mm-hmm. You just have to prioritize what you want when you want to do it.
Right.
You know what I mean? And make it work. Because a while when I started doing both and taking both seriously, it was hard to juggle both, because it's like, you're trying to be a world-class athlete, but at the same time, you want a big break as a filmmaker. But eventually, I learned how to juggle the time just with time. I just learned how to do both. And now I'm at the point where I can go back and forth and it not be too stressful. Because just let alone, as you know, being an independent filmmaker, it's a lot of stress and there's a lot of work and there's a lot of pressure that you put on yourself.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Because you have expectations for yourself.
Right.
And you want to reach a certain level. So you push yourself, right. You know. But the biggest thing I've learned through the years is just kind of just to have fun with it and just let it happen and let things happen when it's supposed to.
Who are some of your favorite filmmakers and also maybe some of your favorite athletes that you draw inspiration from?
Well, I know filmmakers right off the back of my hand. Quentin Tarantino, I think he's awesome.
Yeah,
he's kind of quirky, weird, but
he's his own person.
Right, he's his own person.
For better or worse, he's always himself.
He's in his own lane, I'll tell you that much. And then, of course, new inspirations like Jordan Peele. He's someone that's opening doors, and I think he has a brilliant mind.
We were just talking about Us.
Yeah, we're just talking about Us. Interesting concept of a film. So you have new people like him and like Ryan Coogler and stuff like that. But then my ultimate is Steven Spielberg. Like, of course, Jurassic Park is my favorite film of all time, and that was directed by Steven Spielberg. But I think he's a genius. He's like Hollywood royalty at this point.
Yeah.
You know, to be able to work with him or even meet him one day would just be like,
right? The stuff you could learn in 5 minutes from him.
Yeah. I mean,
or anyone, you know.
Because these guys have worked with actual film.
Yeah.
So I feel like they have a different perspective than a lot of these newer schools. Like, they worked with film where you actually had to sit in the studio and cut it. And it was a little bit more complicated.
Right.
Time consuming.
Well, I mean, and you have a unique perspective. I mean, from the track world, you've trained with people like Coach Williams, George Williams, who has coached, you know, the U.S. Olympic team and the Greece games. And I mean, you know, all kinds of wisdom and experience there. And I think you can apply the same to filmmakers. And I think, like, you know, a lot of times in the new generation, there's always people who want to just like do their own thing. And they're like, you know, whatever to who came before. But I think there's also a lot of lessons, and I've heard you talk about that with both track and film. Maybe like what are some things that you've learned from folks like that, whether it's your coaches or, you know, people in the film world?
The biggest thing that I always go to is just being resilient.
Right.
And I think as humans, we all have that. You kind of have to be.
It's like an instinct.
Yeah, it's an instinct that we all have. Some people can't handle it and they do fail and they give up. But majority of us, I think it's just the instinct. You just have to be resilient and bounce back. There are moments where you lose races. It feels like shit. And then you keep it going. You go back to training and you go back to square one, do what you got to do to win. And filmmaking is kind of the same thing. Sometimes you're not going to win every competition you submit into, or you may get rejected from a film festival.
It's a lot of that out
there.
You know, it's a lot of that out there.
It sucks. But it's part of it. And you have to learn how to be rejected. You have to learn that everyone's not going to like your shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, they're just not.
I was going to say.
You just have to accept that and accept people for that.
And you may not want them to just love everything you do because, honestly, you know, I mean, films that are just technically great films, but don't have something either kind of, you know, different about them or kind of a message that's like subversive or something they're trying to say that's different. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you'll just forget about it until someone reminds you. And it's oftentimes like those films that it's like, you know, the one where you see the reviews on Amazon and it's like people, like there's a bunch of people that loved it and a bunch of people that hated it. And it's like, oh, that's interesting. Like, what's the divide? What's going on there? Like,
What do they see? You know?
Yeah. It's like someone seeing something different than someone else, and that's better than just sort of a you know, like, unique or just this blend of everyone agreeing,
right?
You know? And so
I'd rather have more people say I hate it and give me a thumbs down than everyone say, oh, I liked it, and then have nothing else to say.
Yeah, because if you don't have something to say about one of my films, I think you miss the either miss the point or I miss the point.
Right Somebody
that's the thing. I mean, like,
yeah,
and if you're a filmmaker, you ideally want to be saying something, and it doesn't have to be, you know, the most philosophical groundbreaking thing ever. And like, that's what we talk about so much on the show is like, artists put all this expectation on themselves.
Yeah.
And they're like, you know, if I'm making something in the world, it's 2019, what hasn't been said?
Right.
You know, and it's hard. Like, a lot has been said, but I think if you're kind of crafty in how you say it, you can sort of adapt something from your perspective or something that, you know, yes, may have been technically said, but you're adding a different flavor to it.
And that's true.
Everyone has a different way they can do that.
Exactly.
With your work right now, like, where's your mind at? I know you just finished your first feature film and you're kind of getting ready to put that out into the world soon. And can you talk about that?
Yeah. Well, I'll give you some background to the story. I haven't really told anybody this, and I don't know if I should. But why not? This is live, right? So I was living in Atlanta last year during the whole pursuing the film career thing. And it was hard to get a break down there, honestly. So I was working regular jobs just to make ends meet. I was staying on friends' couches.
Right.
And honestly, at one point I was living out of my car.
Right.
Because, you know, I was bouncing from house to house and trying to work jobs here and there. And eventually I had to live out of my car during the summer. And it was really hard because in that moment, I was in the middle of filming my feature.
Really?
And so I would go to sleep in my car. It was really hot. It was like 90 degrees outside. I would sleep with my doors open and then like wake up the next day and prepare for the shoot. A lot of people didn't know that, but it was just something that I went through that I didn't want to go through, but apparently at the time I had to. A lot of like my parents, of course, they love me. They're like, come home. But they didn't understand it was my goal to get this film out there. It was a story that I had written, and I was like, it was my experience. And I was like, the only person that's going to get it out is me. So I got to persevere and get this story out there. If I don't get it, if I just quit now, then I feel like I just failed myself. So I was like, if I have to stay in my car a couple more months, I'm going to do it. And that's what I did. I finally grinded out and finally got it finished. And then I moved home. Because I was like, okay, I can't keep sleeping out of my car.
Oh, sure, sure.
But
did you kind of hit a point down there where you said, you know, it has to be Atlanta. You've got the connections that, you know, you had hustled to find once you got there. And it was a matter of just seeing it through.
Yeah.
That's sort of the biggest thing.
That's basically what it was. Because I didn't expect that, like, going down there. I was very optimistic.
Right.
I was like, you know, I have a place to stay for the moment. Didn't think it through fully. But I was like, this is what my situation. I found the actors. I found the actors, they all agreed to do it for free, which is a huge blessing.
Oh, for sure.
So that took the weight off, right? Because that's a whole nother layer.
Yeah. Well, and people get weird about that. Like sometimes people say, oh, you know, I won't do this for free. You should never work for free. And I always say, you know, and I've helped people in return. And I think it just depends, like, what is the project? Because if the project you don't feel invested in, you don't care about the story, then you definitely shouldn't do it for free. But if you love the story and you feel like there's an opportunity to like change, you know, a perspective or say something new, I'm always down to get involved.
Right.
But I mean, you know, that's me. So you know, everyone's different. But so what was the biggest lesson that you maybe learned from that production? And I know you said you had a pretty grueling schedule, and then obviously having, you know, a different living circumstance than normal, that's going to add additional challenges.
Yeah. I guess there are a lot of things I learned from it, but the biggest thing was just finishing my task all the way to the end. Because so many people that do love me were saying, hey, just stop. Like one of my coworkers, I told her what I was doing. She was like, maybe you should just go home. And like, I know she had my best interest at heart, but she didn't understand I really needed to get this story out there. And everyone was like, just go home. But I was like in the middle of filming. We were halfway done filming the story. I was like, I can't just stop now.
Right.
So I just found some type of fuel and I kept going. It was hard because, I mean, late nights, you know, in the car, and it was really hot.
Right.
I was just like, I don't know if I could do this. But I had to stick it out, you know.
And you feel it was worth it in the end.
I feel like it was worth it, because if I would have came home, if I would have never finished the story, it'd be unfinished. And I would never be able to say, oh, I finished the feature. Or, you know, I would still be saying, oh, one day I'll do a feature. You know what I mean? But now I feel like you have to do, if you haven't done a film before, you have to get that first short film out. You have to get your first feature out, because it gets the webs out.
Oh, yeah, easily.
You have to, because you learn so many things in the process.
And then you can apply it to the next
thing. Yeah.
And you think, I mean, do you agree, like, people should definitely experiment with some different types of shorts before they settle on a feature? Or do you think it doesn't matter if you've got something to say?
It depends. I think it depends on your resources.
Right.
And how fast you catch on. I think it should take a few short films before a feature. Some people have done the straight to feature, and they've done amazing jobs. But I also think it's who you're connected to and what knowledge do you have, you know, aside from, you know, the short film or just in the film industry in general. Do you know a lot about cameras, about how to multitask and scheduling? If you know how to plan things and put things in planning, then it works. But I think it takes like practice.
Oh, yeah. And I mean, you feel, I mean, I can only speak for myself, but I'm really glad I wasn't handed, you know, I mean, I guess it would have been great if I was handed millions of dollars to go my first feature. but in a way, in hindsight, I'm sort of glad I wasn't handed a big check because I had to really grind and I had mm-hmm. to, you know, do the late nights and, you know, work with crew and like kind of mm-hmm. collaborate on creative ways to get people compensated, whether if it was money or just getting like gas in their tank and just like collaborating together and mm-hmm. then putting trust in me, you know? And it's like, would you say the same for your feature? Cause I feel like it taught me a lesson I would have never learned if I mm-hmm. had just been handed it.
That's true. I agree. I think it builds integrity. Mm-hmm. It builds all those strong morals that you need once you get your foot in the door. So the biggest thing is learning how to work with people. And I feel like if you can work with people with what you love for free, right. then you can deal with it when you are doing it as a career and it's sustaining yeah. your life.
Yeah.
So I agree.
Yeah.
It teaches you that.
So you're here in kind of Raleigh, North Carolina area. Mm-hmm. What do you find interesting here? Because I know right now, kind of shifting back into the track world, you're currently training and you're about to head over to Granada for their invitational. And then you're also got your sights set on Tokyo 2020 for the Olympics.
Yeah.
Can you talk to me a little bit about training here, living here and working here for that?
Yeah. So much pressure.
Yeah. Yeah. I was going to say it's a mouthful.
Right.
Yeah. Got all the sound bites and what I just said.
Right. All in one.
Right.
I mean, it's new pressure, but it's not pressure I haven't dealt with before.
Yeah, I was going to say.
So now is I like yeah. it. You know right. what I mean? I
You're can, used to it.
Yeah, I'm used to it yeah. at this point. So I feed off of it. But if anything, yeah, now it's just getting more projects out, remaining creative
right.
and continue working hard on the track. And, right. you know, 2020 will be here before you know it. You know, World Championships are this year. So mm-hmm. that's the main focus is right. just to make another team. And then after that, World Championships, and then next year's Olympic.
Right.
So,
and I mean, you've been working in the Olympic cycle, really going back to the Beijing one, right?
2008. Yeah, that's Beijing. Yeah.
So Beijing, and yeah. you, I mean, you've seen what it takes. You've seen trials. You've seen all the lead up races. Can you talk to me about like what keeps you going? Is it sort of that same thing like we were just talking with film, where it's like, you know, you've invested time and you want to just see it through and you've kind of learned perspective. And I mean, I can only speak from what I've seen from you just because we have the unique relationship of doing the documentary.
Yeah.
But I mean, I definitely am curious to hear your take on it too.
Well, I think the biggest thing, a lot of people in track and field say, run into the, you know, you can't run anymore mm. until the wheels fall off. Mm. And so yeah, you hear that constantly. And so that's been instilled in me through the year, especially dealing with or speaking with veterans in the sport. And they're like, why stop now? If you're still healthy, if you can still stretch and touch your toes, if you still eat healthy, why not?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And so I think about it like that. Like, I'm still healthy. I can still go out on the track and compete with those young chickens. So I'm like, I'm a little bit more seasoned now, but that's okay. It's okay to be a little bit more seasoned. And I look at it in that way.
Yeah.
So I just look at it now. I'm a little bit more... I'm mentally strong, and I just know what to expect now.
Yeah.
And I know what work it takes to get there. So it's a process. It's hard, but I know what it takes. So at this point, I'm content with where I am, and I'm just going to go for it.
100%.
Yeah.
So this just popped in my head. So something you were just saying is very interesting, because I feel like in the film world, and we've both worked on sets that like we've, you know, been the cable wrangler and we've grabbed, you know, people coffee and stuff. And like, you see that relationship where they value the age and being older and having experience mm-hmm. and like being a younger person in film. It's you in you know, the system of film, it's usually, you know, you have, reverence towards people who are older and been there. But I feel mm-hmm. like with athletics, it's the opposite. And people look to the youngest person and they always say like, who's the youngest person doing the most for their age? Mm-hmm. And like, it's a weird, I mean, both of those just run totally opposite.
Yeah, that's so
and
true.
And you operate in both worlds.
Yeah, I never thought about that. Yeah. That's an interesting dynamic.
It just
dynamic.
Dawned on me.
Yeah, that's an interesting perspective. I didn't think about that, but it's true. Like in the sporting world, the younger you are, the fresher you are, the more marketable mm-hmm. you are. And so the longer you've been in the sport, you have to be 10 times better than you were when you were 20 or those 20 year olds now.
Right.
You really have to be 10 times better or it's like, what have you done for me lately? Basically,
mm-hmm.
you know, that's the way these sporting companies are looking at it. And you can't blame them. Of course, they want something young and hot.
And like, I can only speak to the film side, mm-hmm. but you know, for me, I found this kind of happy medium where, you know, I kind of operate, and so do you, I mean, outside of the, you know, system of mm-hmm. filmmaking, but, you know, we dabble our toe back in for film festivals and stuff like that, because mm-hmm. I think there's so much more creative freedom in doing it yourself.
Yeah.
And, you know, in terms of, you know, going against a system like that, there can be backlash. People can say, oh, why are you doing this? Are you entitled? How could you make a film, a feature film in your 20s or whatever? And like, you know, because some people are in their 50s and they're still PAing and they're trying to like work their way up the DGA system and all that stuff. And, you know, that's great. And I think, you know, there can be many roads that lead to the same path. It's just for me, I found a road that works for me.
Right.
And I think that's sort of what you're hinting at, is that people expect, you know, if you're an athlete, you go down this road until you can't anymore, and then you you know, coach or do whatever. And like, I think you're experimenting. Can you talk about that? Because I think, you know, between what you've done, like, you know, you technically retired from track for like a little minute,
right?
And then you came back, and now you're experimenting with that, and you're doing, you know, feature and all these new things with film here in North Carolina.
Right. Well, the advantage is of film is you do get to experiment forever.
Right.
It's just like a forever experimentation, which is fun.
You can do that till you drop.
Yeah. It make it work for you.
Yeah.
But as you know, track, it is hard to experiment because it's like, all right, there's time's ticking.
Right.
You know, and fortunately, thank God, I'm able to come back to it and experiment a little bit more and say, let me try it again. Because a lot of people, they stop. It's kind of like going to college, or you either make the decision to either go to college after high school or you don't. If you don't go to college, or do. If you don't go to college, then it's harder to go back.
100%.
Or even after college, go straight and get your master's, or you're going to forget. It's hard to retain information.
Right.
So it's the same thing with track and field.
Yeah.
It's like, or in sports in general, you take a break. When you come back, your body's like, hold up.
You feel that break.
Yeah. You, and it makes training that much harder just to get back where you left off. And then you have to get back to where you were when you were good. So that transition is very difficult.
Yeah.
But not a lot of people are willing to endure it. But I figure, why not?
Yeah. No, I mean, in that break you're talking about, like, I kind of pseudo did that last year with film. And like, I made music videos and I was working, you know, full time making videos and, you know, kind of other types of things for other people. And I realized I hadn't wrote a script going on a year plus. And I was like,
that's a long time
for me. Yeah. I mean, you know, and I was making stuff, and I think, like, you know, I'm definitely wasn't doing nothing, but at the same time, I wasn't engaging a part of my brain that was like screaming for attention.
Yeah.
And then I recently started writing a new feature, and, you know, now I'm just getting into a point where I feel good about what I'm writing, but it took months and months and months just to like feel like what I was writing had substance. And I had never felt that way before. It was super strange.
That's
and like, that's what's the point of the show, is to like share that stuff, is like, you know, the show is kind of me discovering stuff along the way and like getting perspective from the guests and people who are on the show. But have you dealt with that? Like, because normally when I wrote stuff, it would always be from a place of like extreme excitement. But then lately it was like trying to force it out. But it was because, like you said, I had been on a break.
You had been on a break.
And then
right.
I felt it. And I was like, I'm using a part of my brain that had some cobwebs. Like,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And you and as a creator, you if you are away from it that long, you actually have to force it out.
Right, right.
Because either way, it's not going to come out any other way.
Yeah. No. And like, I told myself, film is film. But at the same time, a music video is a different type of film. A corporate video is a different type of film. A documentary is a different type of film. And I'm trying to do a narrative feature.
Yeah.
And like writing. And I'm like, what is writing? Like, you know, and like all that stuff. So tell me a little bit about why do you like working outside of the system, quote unquote, with film? And I would also even say with track a little bit, because you've talked about how, not that you shy away from sponsors, but you've kind of either found smaller businesses to work with. You've, you know, tagged your shoes instead of with tape. You've colored them with paint. And you've kind of made bold like statements with your clothing. Can you talk a little bit about like why you do that and like what kind of gives you that fire?
Well, I think nowadays that's just the way this generation is moving.
100%.
They're more independent on the way they move.
Right.
Their business ideas, just the way they conceptualize things.
Right.
And I don't know if it has a lot to do with social media or technology. It probably does.
Probably has something to do. Yeah.
Right.
I mean, it permeates in so many ways.
Yeah, it does. Yeah. And so it's like you kind of have to follow the trend a little bit.
Right.
And so instead of back in the day as a rap artist or a singer, you know, the big thing was getting a major label, right?
Right.
But now you can just throw a song on YouTube or SoundCloud and generate so much buzz.
And the artists are making their label. I mean, yeah, literally here in Raleigh this weekend, J. Cole's bringing Dreamville Festival. You know, I can't wait for it.
Yeah, a lot of people
I have a ticket and I'm very excited. But it's like that. I mean, like, you know, he, you know, made his own label. He signed other artists. He's given other artists opportunities. Mm-hmm. And like that took time. But, you know, I think it's not like everyone's running to Universal Records or whatever, right, you know.
And they're awesome, but at the same time, they're just not signing any anybody. You know what I mean?
I feel like the groundbreaking stuff is coming from the ground level. Like,
yeah.
I mean, I feel like truly, like, you know, all the stuff that's blowing up, it's like whether it's a viral video that someone just made and went for. I mean, the winning film at this past, in 2018, South by Southwest was Thunder Road, which, I mean, was literally just people pulling resources together and making a feature film totally outside of the system.
That's crazy.
With like no cast that was super known or anything. I mean, and, you know, there's no A-list stars, but it was a human film and it had such heart. And I mean, it's like stuff like that. I mean, like all of hip hop right now is self-made people.
Yeah.
Like, that's the people you're hearing about. Like the people who are stuck in contracts, like that's what people say don't do.
Right, right.
Like in their songs, they're like, don't get stuck in a contract for 20 years. And like,
I'm about to say, the only way I'm going to get stuck in a contract is if you paying me.
Right. I mean, if it's a good...
If you paying me.
Yeah.
But then again, as an artist, you want to be able to... Free to do stuff. So
but, you know,
who
I
wants
mean,
to be stuck?
Yeah, I mean, if you're trying to pay me to be stuck with millions of dollars, I mean, right, maybe, it depends how much maybe being stuck isn't that bad.
Right. It ain't that bad. I just got to wait 3 to 5 years. But,
right, right.
But then it is hard. That is hard as an artist. It's like being a basketball player and people say, oh, this person's hurting. They're still getting paid $50 million, but they want to play.
Yeah.
You know, there's no point in getting paid if you're not playing.
Right. 100%. Yeah.
You know,
I know you talked about this in the documentary, but I feel like it would be interesting to explain here, outside of like baseball, football, basketball, not a lot of other sports have crazy high salaries or salaries at all. Can you kind of talk about that? Because I feel like people have an impression about, you know, oh, you're if you're an Olympic qualifying event, you must be raking it in.
Right.
Which is not the case.
Definitely not the case, unfortunately. And that's a lot of Olympic sports. That's gymnastics, swimming, fencing, all those sports. I have a friend who bobsleds, and he's awesome.
Okay.
But they make damn near no money.
Right.
Like they sacrifice just as many hours as other athletes.
See,
Olympic
and that's
athletes.
The thing that's like fascinating. It's like,
yeah.
I mean, I've been out on the track. I've seen you train. I mean, like you do the same amount of work. And you're just not compensated in this organized way, like, you know, the NBA or whatever.
Yeah, not at all. And it's like, we always say in track and field, track is the oldest sport, but seems to be the oldest sport seems to be the most forgotten sport.
That's
I mean, it's
true.
The most basic sport out of
you
anything.
Run,
you
right,
run, you
right.
race with your kids, you're like, let's race.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, who's the fastest?
Right.
And of course, those guys, they make more money than anybody, but even them, they're making a small fraction of what basketball play, maybe not even a small fraction.
That's true. It is kind of crazy like how the salaries work, and it's like super different in track and field. So I guess like kind of going forward, you're gonna drop a feature, you're gonna try to do the Olympics again. Where's your mind at? Like, what is the kind of default space? Because I feel like you either have to be super zen and calm, or you have to really be able to just like slide real quick back and forth between film mode and track mode.
I think it's a combination of it all.
Right.
You have to learn the balance. You have to know how to slide in and out, where you fit in. And then also you just have to find your zen.
Right.
You really do. And this past few months, especially after, you know, the Atlanta situation and everything, I'm back home and I've been, you know, getting more spiritual, reading my Bible, just praying more and spending more time, you know, praying and staring into the ceiling, and then also hanging with family. I think family centers you.
Yeah, those things are important. I mean, sometimes like people talk about like you always have to be hustling and grinding, but sometimes like you do just need to stare at the wall and like get lost in whatever.
It's so true. You just need those moments of quietness.
Yeah, that's really undervalued, I feel like, too, as a I mean, as an artist, as an athlete, just in American culture in general, because it's like everything everything's like business and work and hustle. I mean, even creative stuff, even though it's creative, people still like can work themselves to the bone.
Yeah.
And like,
even when you're not working, you're thinking about what
it's
you're trying
healthy.
To create. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
It's not at all.
And I found, too, like people always talk about like the kind of, you know, the tortured artist complex where you create the best work when you're not happy or whatever. But like, I feel like when your basic needs are met, you create way better work because you're actually like comfortable. And I mean, you don't want to get so comfortable that you're not working.
Right, right.
But I feel like that's where people can actually take risk, because if you're just struggling to like pay a bill or do this or that, like you may not have time to think about X, Y, and Z.
That's true. And I think that has a lot to do with the new school mentality.
Yeah.
The way the new generation just moves.
The self-care. Well, I feel like our generation is more about self-care and more about mental health.
Yeah.
And like we actually like admit things.
That's
like,
true.
Because I feel like, you know, not a disrespect to anyone before, but I feel like a lot of times people would just sort of sugarcoat and be like, oh, everything's fine.
Just cover it up.
You know, just put on a happy face and smile. But I feel like, you know,
now if you're not happy or if you're disappointed, you're like, I'm disappointed.
Right. And people are just more confident to talk about what's going on. And I mean, like, it doesn't mean you have a solution, because I feel like that's the thing everyone expects. Oh, if I'm talking about it, I have to know a solution.
Right.
And I think part of it is getting lost in the process and just saying, this is something I'm figuring out.
Exactly.
Like, you know, that's literally the point of the show. It's like, the title is convincing creatives. And does that mean the creatives are convincing, or do they need convincing? Are we convincing them?
Yeah.
And so it's like, you know, shameless self-promotion, but you know, it's like, that's it. But it's like, are we getting lost in the process? Cause I feel like, you know, like you were saying, you got to stare at the ceiling sometimes to like think about things and digest.
That's important. Yeah,
totally.
That's very important. It's so easy to get lost, especially with social media. Oh, you see everyone else, their creations and what they're doing. Because I know on Instagram, I follow hashtag cinematography and hashtag, I think, just movie directors.
Right.
And I'm constantly seeing like these crazy visual images and equipment that I'm not yet able to afford. So sometimes that gets in your head and you're like, oh, people are creating all this beautiful content. And then I have this little camera.
And it's like, this camera's not the latest. It's like, you get down on yourself.
Right, right.
You're like, I can't make a film until I get that next camera.
Exactly.
And it's
right?
like, really, you can just dust off that camera you have.
Yeah.
But it's
you don't
that,
need that $10,000 camera. Right. It would help.
Oh, sure. It would help. But it's like, but if that's what's keeping you from doing it, you know, if that camera is going to help you do it better, then save up and get it. But it's like, you know, I think a lot of people use that as a crutch.
They do.
And a lot of people just kind of say, oh, well, you know, I'll let the time fly. But then 5 years go by and you've not made anything.
Exactly.
You know? And I feel like that's the trap, is that people, like you said on social media, it's like you get lost in the comparison mindset.
Yeah.
And it's dangerous.
It's so dangerous.
So dangerous.
And it has a lot to do with the mental health. You know?
Well, I ask people this now, is like, how often do you get on social media and open the app? And then when you get off, are you ever actually any happier than when you started?
That's true.
Because I've never found what I'm looking for.
That's true.
Whatever it is. And I still do it. Like, I'm not saying I don't.
Right. That is like,
I still do. I will go home after this and probably
and probably look through Instagram.
But it's like very strange psychologically. It's like how that works.
That's true.
And like, I don't believe, like, I know some people are like, just delete it all, get off of it. I don't believe in that.
Yeah.
I think there is a lot of good that comes out of it. Because I kind of think it, I mean, it's a tool at the end of the day.
Yeah.
And it's how you use it. It's no different than like a hammer or a screwdriver.
Right.
But it's just a lot more addicting.
Right.
A hammer or a screwdriver.
Right. Exactly.
You know,
it's just like
it's
don't abuse it.
Way,
yeah. Yeah. It is, unfortunately.
Yeah.
You gotta know your balance.
100%. And I think there's like hacks you can kind of have where, you know, some people are like, turn the black and white on your phone so then the icons aren't so tempting and you know, all
That's
this
true.
Stuff. But That's you know, true. I think it's like you said, it's just sort of getting in your own self interest and kind of saying, okay, what do I need out of this? And then once you get it, or once you feel like you're not getting it, maybe that's even more important, sort of saying, all right, I'm gonna hop off of this right now and go write or go work out or do something different.
Exactly. Need that balance.
Yeah. So like on a totally different random note, going back to Run of the Picture, which you guys can all watch on Amazon Prime Video, shameless self-promotion. We want you to go watch
it. Plug in.
You know, we've been making it for 5 years. What are you gonna do? Just leave it sitting there? I mean, you gotta watch it.
You gotta do something. Somebody gotta watch
it's free if you have Prime. Go check it out. But like in terms of the documentary, like I'm just curious, this is just my own sheer curiosity, like what did it feel like being documented? Like, was that a weird experience, or was it just like you're around cameras and stuff, were you kind of used to that? Or
I guess being around cameras, it
because you have
help
press experience
too, so that
when you're
did
traveling
help.
For races and stuff.
Exactly, because I did think honestly during the 2016 Olympics, I thought maybe it would be kind of in the way. I was thinking maybe it'll cut my focus, but it didn't.
Yeah.
It really didn't at all. It was there and I was like, whatever.
Well, see, and that's the thing, like, I always am very cognizant of is like, and I've like, you know, I'm a documentary nerd. I love narrative film too, but like, I listen to a lot of documentary filmmakers and like a lot of my heroes always talk about like, you have to understand there's like points where you go in and you get that's what true. You need and you kind of, you know, press the subject for a question, but there's other points where you just kind of like hang back and observe, and it's sort of just like knowing what to do where. And I mean, I don't know, I think
you did a great job at that. I never felt like, oh my god, she's in the way. I never
like felt sticking like a camera in your
right
face.
Right, like, oh, yeah. Okay.
Well, thanks, I appreciate that.
It was a great balance. It was, especially during 2016 Olympics. Like, I've at moments I felt like you weren't there.
Good.
You know what I mean? I'm like, when did he get that shot?
Right. Like, yeah, it's like being, you know, fly on the wall during that whole lead up is like, you know, that whole season, you know, you were very focused, and I could tell, you know, when you were in a headspace to answer a question versus maybe like when it would be a better time to just get B-roll and just sort of like. And that's the other thing too, is like, I think as documentation goes, you have this sort of, you know, thought where it's like, I always have to get interview, and like interviews are great, but I actually didn't use that many on-camera interviews. I used a lot of like the audio, but using the B-roll to really sell the story and kind of show rather than tell. Which I think is hard, because I think a lot of times in documentary, you get lost in just sort of like every word, but it's really more about like a feeling and a collective of events.
Right. But that was awesome you did that, because we did do a lot of sit down interviews.
We did, yeah.
I like how you didn't really have to use any of them. You just used
I mean, I used a little bit of the audio, and then we did like an audio interview only, which was super helpful.
Right, that's true.
Because we also could like sit this close to the mic, and you'd have to worry about the camera, and so the audio quality was dope.
Exactly.
But it actually kind of forces you to rely more on B-roll. And I had just come from doing a bunch of like music videos, and so I was so used to not having audio, and it kind of was a helpful way. It's like weird how stuff, do you ever notice that, like within film, or I mean, you probably noticed it too. I mean, you talked about it at the end of Run of the Picture, was you were saying like, track has shaped my worldview and my narrative and my discipline that I now apply to filmmaking, and without it I wouldn't be the filmmaker that I am.
Right.
And like, that was something really interesting that resonated with me. Could you maybe speak more to that?
Yeah, like, just, I mean, you know, I've done track and field most of my life, but it's instilled so many morals in my life.
Right.
And like I said before, resilience and perseverance and finishing it to the end. And that's why I said I was going to retire. But then, you know, I've been doing it so long, and it did teach me integrity and just not giving up. And so that's when I had to come back, because I was just like, but maybe it's, you know, maybe it's not over just
yet.
It's like my gut was telling me there's more to the story. And no, whatever, regardless of what the outcome is, it's just not over yet.
Yeah. And I mean, like, the wild thing is, this is how I always think about everything now. And I think actually making this documentary about you kind of helped me reach this conclusion just in life, is that I feel like so often we get so short-sighted. And what that means is like, we're over here trying to say, well, we have to achieve X, Y, and Z and get this award and get this thing, get that. And like, that's all great if you get it.
Yeah.
But people forget that you're on like a line in a chapter, and you've still got like half a book here. And it's like, even if you don't get that thing, you've learned so much lessons that you apply to a totally different and unrelated thing in your life that just makes you way stronger and more interesting.
That's true.
Because like, if you walk into something else with all this, you know, knowledge from that, you're just all of a sudden way more marketable and interesting.
That's true.
I mean, I don't know. Like, that's why I think a lot of times, like people, like, for example, who are in the military, like when they get out of service, they have a very unique skill set, but then they find work in all kinds of different ways. And I think our society definitely could do way better. But like, when they do, like, you see a lot of interesting things happen. Like, there's a lot of entrepreneurship in that community. And I think it's super just interesting in general when you can take a skill set that you think is unrelated, but then find a way to relate it.
Exactly. So. And it's crazy you say that, because I always assumed, like, leaving a season or finishing a season with the medal, being a champion, I always thought there would be so many opportunities that come with that, which there are.
Oh, sure, yeah.
But there are just as many opportunities without it, like you said, with the lessons that you learn. Yeah. You just have to know that. Because I think that's what held me back, you know, after a season that didn't go well. I will be down on myself, and then the rest of the year I'm just like, oh, well, there's no opportunities because I didn't have a good season. But honestly, there's more opportunities. You just have to be optimistic.
Right. And you have to look for them.
We
do. I think that's the thing, is like, kind of, you can't be content to just kind of like be like, all right, I'm going to wait for it to all happen.
Right.
Because that usually never happens that way. Mm-hmm. It's usually you pressing a situation.
Mm-hmm.
Have you, I will say this. I went through a weird point where it was like right after I made my first feature, Son of Clowns, mm-hmm. I kind of didn't know what to do next. Like I had this very applicable skill set. I knew I could go make another feature that way, but it's really, I mean, I still technically haven't made my next narrative feature. I'm writing it and I made, you know, a TV show. So that was like long form and different, but I didn't know what to do with it because I didn't feel for a while that it achieved, you know, the Sundance Film Festival, or it didn't achieve major acclaim, or, you know, this, that, and the third. But it's like being distant from it, you know, coming back to it as my older self, I look back and I'm like, no, there was a lot that happened. I just wasn't listening.
Yeah.
You know, and like that's the thing. I was so caught up in like trying to look up. Mm-hmm. I wasn't actually looking level and seeing what was happening in that moment.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like looking back, I'm like, oh no, there was, you know, interesting stuff going on. But I think that's like human nature.
Do you feel like you could have done a little bit more with Son of Clouds, being that you were looking up the whole time? Mm-hmm. There was so much, many more opportunities available.
Yeah. And I don't know, like sometimes I do. And then other times I'm like, no, I definitely like gave it my all. And, you know, like,
yeah.
And I think it's just that part of the artist brain where you kind of wrestle with it. And it's like, in hindsight, you could always say, well, I could have stayed up one more hour and emailed, you know, but at a certain point,
now, was that the email that you needed?
Yeah. It's like, was it that last one that you went to bed? You know,
right.
It's like, you know, but at a certain point, like, it's just like you have to call it. And like, you know, and it's always weird, like, and this is just a very personal weird thing for me.
Mm-hmm.
It's always weird when like you kind of do that market cycle with a film where that's your thing that you're plugging. And then there comes a point where it's like, no, I don't talk about that anymore. I have something new. And it's like weird because you're like, but I still have a connection to that.
Mm-hmm.
And I still want you to see it. But the time, it's like its season has passed.
Yeah.
And like, you don't want, you can't cling to it anymore. Like you need to just let it out, you know? And actually, I think that's the moment for me as a filmmaker where I have felt the most relief, where I'm able to just let it go.
Because
it feels like I've done it, whatever it needed, I've just done it, you know? And it's like, that's you kind of cut all the, you know, the ropes ties from the boat, and they just float away.
That's true.
So
I didn't think about that.
Yeah. I don't know. That's just a very personal thing. It's like very strange because some people don't promote their film that much. They just like do one post. Mm-hmm. For me, I got to promote it. Like if I waste all the time making it,
I got to waste all the time promoting it for
which better is true. Or worse.
And, that's true.
And like that's part of operating. It's like a very conscious choice. And like you do a good job of this too. I've seen through your stuff and your films.
Mm-hmm.
And I definitely am curious like how you manage it. But for me, it's just like knowing that's part of the equation. I don't worry about it. Like it's not my favorite thing. I'll be straight up.
Mm-hmm.
But I know that if I'm working outside of a Hollywood system or a studio system that has people doing that for you, I signed a contract in my own head when I decided to not be in that system where I go do that. And so for me, it feels like part of it. Like it's like the fourth stage of production.
Right. And that's good. That's great preparation because one day you are going to get to that level, and it's going to, that phase is important.
It just is
as important as the production, post-production phase. Yeah. I find that the last phase of it, it's exciting, but then it can suck sometimes just because you're excited about it because it's like your baby. You feel like it's your masterpiece. Right. But other people aren't as excited as you feel they should be.
Right.
And so it kind of, so sometimes you find yourself dumbing it down because you're like, well, you know what? I'm excited, but no one else really gives a crap. You know what I mean? And then in some cases, people are just as excited as you.
Right.
And especially if you're going through the film festival circuit, like we were saying before, you have to be very patient. And so you can have all this energy around it. Yeah. And then you submit it to four or five festivals and then you have to wait. Mm-hmm. And then your energy just kind of.
100%. And then it's this weird, you have to like just push and wait. And it's like so many emotions and there's so much patience.
Because you have to disconnect yourself from it because you don't want to psych yourself out.
Right. And that's such a huge thing. And like that's, I think, what leads to a lot of people not making follow up.
Mm-hmm.
It's like they'll do something and they'll get crushed in that process.
Yeah.
Because it can be crushing. But it's like, do you know how to wade those waters?
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, I don't know. I think that's what's super interesting about being a creative in 2019 is that you have so much at your disposal with the internet. But at the same time, it's like, it sometimes feels like shouting in the void.
Because
I mean, I kind of got to a point where maybe I got too pessimistic, but mm-hmm. I kind of got that way where I'm like, I just put a little post out and like whatever, and mm-hmm. people will find it if they want. And like, then I realized, I was like, no, I'm not getting as much traction that way. And like, mm-hmm. I got to believe in it.
You do.
And that's part of it is you like, do. And I think we suppress that because it's like, you don't want to look like you care too much.
Exactly.
But it's like, if you put all the time into making it, you should care. And to be fair, like, I want to watch work from people that care. I don't want to watch work from people that are like, trying to look cool, because right, like exactly. that's not an artist. I mean, mm-hmm. I don't know. And like, you know, that's you don't so want to spam people, but you do want to be invested in your own work,
right?
Because I mean, that was right. the thing with this movie, with Run of the Pictures. Like, mm-hmm. I've been working on it so long, but I've also, you know, like, I haven't talked about it a lot during the process, but I would mention it every couple months.
Every now and then.
And it's, you know, it's very seldom. And then I kind of mm-hmm. forgot about that. And so when I put that trailer out yesterday, I'm like, I bet this is the first time so many people have heard about this. And mm-hmm. then so many people were like, oh, finally. This, and I was like, that's true. I guess they have been,
they've been waiting.
Wondering. And they, you know, it's like, but I wasn't overwhelming them either. So
right. And that's awesome that they're like, finally.
Yeah.
That's like, awesome.
That was dope. Because I'd never reaction. Experienced that till yesterday. Yeah. And I was like, you know, because normally my films are not 5 years in the making. Right. And so this was a very different type of film, you know, being a documentary like that. But yeah. I mean, it was fascinating and just how that worked, you know,
yeah.
And making that kind of just assessment to be like, all right, well, people do feel that way.
Right.
And that makes sense.
I guess I feel that way, too, as far as marketing and promoting. People do have... they're quick just to latch on to something and then move on.
Yeah.
And so like their tolerance is very, it's like a 2-year-old. So I think it has a lot to do with that. It's like you come out with something. Yeah. So it's like, should you put it out now when it's close to when you actually have it out? Or because if you put it out and it's not out, or if you put out a trailer and they can't see it, then they're going to lose attention and then you're going to have to move on. They're going to move on to something else. And then by the time you put it out, like, hey, watch it. They have already moved on.
100%.
So I guess you have to be strategic.
You definitely do. You and do it's like finding the moment, because it's like you don't want to hold it too long to where it like you missed a, you know, a swell of attention that you could attach it to.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, it's about weighing those options.
Yeah.
Yeah. So another thing I'm kind of curious about is sort of, as someone who has, you know, balanced track and film, what would you recommend people go out and do that? I mean, whether it doesn't have to be track and film, but maybe, you know, two different passions, do you think it's better? Like, I'm sure you get perspective.
Yeah. A lot of people have surprisingly asked me this through the years.
I'm sure they have. I was going to say.
Yeah. Like even recently someone asked me that. Maybe someone, a collegiate runner, was like, how do you balance both? And I was like, really? People really want to know that?
But no, it's interesting. Yeah. Because like not many people do that.
Not a lot of people do that. And I didn't really think that. Yeah. But I guess it, I don't know. Because it's a lot. When I first tried to start balancing both, depending on what level athlete you are, because they're pressure that comes with each level but you just have to learn how to balance, and time management is everything.
100%.
And like we were saying before, you have to prioritize what you want to prioritize, when you want to prioritize it. You have to set aside, okay, if you know you want to work on this project or this this idea, I'm going to set aside this amount of time, March through June, I'm gonna set aside that time to work on this feature.
Yeah.
If it doesn't happen, then I have to set aside some other time. You just have to time management, and you have to plan ahead, because as a creative, you do just kind of want to do things on the fly. But if you do have something else that requires focus, you have to manage and you have to prioritize to begin with. So I think the biggest thing with me is if I start writing tonight on a project, I start thinking, okay, what's my track schedule? Right. When do I compete? When am I going to have free time? Right. And I know, okay, I'm not going to have free time until like September, October now. So I'm just going to keep writing until then. And then once that opens up,
ready to go,
that way, when that moment comes, I'll have something already ready.
Yeah. You know? I did notice that through the doc. That was when you were making.
Did you realize that? Yeah.
And I hadn't thought about that till now, but I was like, that is always
those are the
season.
Times. Yeah. Yeah.
And you were always good about that. You always had something to go.
Yeah. So. Yeah. You always have to, you have to be ready. Like when that, because it's free time
100%.
And you have to utilize it.
And you don't want to just sit on the couch. And
not at all. Like, of course it's break, but you don't want to, it's not spring break. It's, you know what I mean? Like,
it's a break from that thing.
Yeah. But you got to keep going. So 100%. It's crazy. You just realize that. Yeah.
Yeah. That's actually very interesting.
That's always after season. I'm like, okay, a production. I got to do something. Like you said, even if you have to force it out.
Yeah. Well, and oftentimes it's only forced the first few days.
Right.
And then you get in a groove and you're it's like discipline. It's like when you mm-hmm. lift a certain weight that you don't normally lift, it's going to hurt a little bit the mm-hmm. first few days until you get used to it.
Right. Exactly. That's
great advice. So the last question I ask everyone on the show, it's always the same for everyone, is as a creative, is there anything that you're currently struggling with or that maybe you've just kind of overcome that you've learned and kind of listened to within yourself that you kind of want to share about the process? Because, you know, the process is difficult and the process can be challenging.
I would say kind of a combination of both. Something that I've learned, I would say, I always go back to perseverance. I guess I get that from track. If you have an idea, film that shit. You know what I mean? Like, you need to film it and write it out. First, write it out and then film it. Like, get whoever wants to help put it together. If no one wants to help, figure out the way to do it by yourself.
Hold the camera.
And hold the camera. Do what you got to do and get it out there, regardless of how it comes out. Just, you got to get it out. You got to get those webs out. Yeah. But then, of course, so for that, I would say if you have an idea, get it out there. But then, of course, I think just like anybody, I've dealt with writer's block. I think that's just something you deal with as a creator. 100%. You kind of struggle. You may have a great idea, but you just have to, it's hard to formulate how you want it to come out on, because you can conceptualize it one way, and then when you put it on paper or type it out, it comes out totally different.
I think that's hard. 100%. I was gonna say, I think that writer's block is in a weird way good, because I think it means you've graduated from that beginning level of working on something, because it's like you're still passionate about it, but you it's like, you know, you can make a film. It's not a matter of like, am I doing rule of thirds right, am I doing the audio right? I mean, it's like, you know, you can do it. It's just a matter of like the content at that point. And so in a way, that just means you've graduated.
You've
leveled up in a way. I think it's totally normal.
And it's healthy. It is 100%, healthy, because no one just spews out idea after idea after idea.
With, I mean,
if you can,
smile,
right? If you can, hey, more power to you. You know what I mean? Studios love that,
right?
But even the greatest ones, they've had to.
Oh yeah,
they go the writer's
block. Well, and I mean, that's the thing. Like, as great as Steven Spielberg is, I mean, he's made some bad films too.
Yeah,
I mean,
like, that's true.
You know, it's not like I love everything he makes.
Exactly.
But, you know, I mean, that's with any filmmaker. And like, what's funny too is it's all subjective.
Right.
Like, you know, I remember certain bands I would listen to back in the day, or artists or something. Like, I'd think one album is like not that great, and other people be like, oh, that's the most underrated one.
I'm right. Like, you're like,
okay.
What?
So you know, it's like you think a totally different way.
Yeah, that's true.
And, you know, that's what's the kind of beautiful thing about it. Just like finding what you can through those processes, because it is so subjective. And just sort of being like, okay, well, y'all can deal with all the critiques and all of the rankings and top 10 lists. I'm going to make the work. And I think that's a healthy place to be.
Yeah.
Because I think as an artist, if you cross the threshold into that world, it's game over.
Yeah, definitely. Because
you're kind of away from the whole point of what it is that you're,
it's like finding your zen. 100%. Once you're there, there's nothing someone can say or rank you to make you feel a certain type of way.
It's sort of unrelated, but it's like, you know, being able to sit in a traffic jam and just crank your music and just be like, I'm here, versus like, just sitting there with rage when there's nothing you can do.
That's true.
Like, that's kind of the way I look at it.
That's interesting.
You know, because it's like you find yourself in these situations whether you want to be there or not.
Yeah.
So you may as well
make the best
enjoy
of it.
That's true. Know, enjoy a jam sesh with your favorite song. I mean, like,
I'm
I don't know.
Saying, I do that all the time.
100%. Raleigh has some terrible traffic right now. Terrible traffic. It's
I don't
growing.
Know why.
I love it.
I guess
because
it's growing. Yeah.
But it, yeah. I mean,
sometimes I look
congestion.
At it, I'm like, it's not that big of a city.
Right.
Why all this traffic? Where
right.
are all these
it's
people coming
out
from?
Nowhere. Stop moving to Raleigh. I'm just kidding. Please move. Hey. It's a wonderful city. Yeah, man. Well, dude, this was dope. I really appreciate you being on the show.
I appreciate you having me.
Yeah,
I had
dude. 100%. Yeah. Last little thing, where can people keep up with you and find you if they want to check out what you're doing?
Yeah, so I'm more active on Instagram and Twitter. Both of my handles are the same. Just follow me at Dutch Filmmaker. Just one word, all one word, Dutch Filmmaker.
Dope. You can see what he's doing film-wise. You can see what he's doing track-wise. Obviously wishing you all the luck in the world with all of it.
Yeah, definitely.
And y'all go check out the documentary. Hope you enjoy
Please
it.
Please do.
Yeah.
He's worked hard on it.
For sports are.
And it's really good. I love the screening. It was awesome. You did awesome.
Yeah, man. We're going to be doing some screenings across the state if you're in North Carolina. And if you're not, again, Amazon Prime, just go check it out. Yeah.
So no excuses.
Yeah, I was going to say, literally no excuses. We will make it as easy as possible. If y'all enjoyed this podcast, consider dropping us a review on iTunes. It's super easy. Rate us 5 stars. And it helps us get seen and discovered in all the algorithm with all the thousands of podcasts. But anyway, Johnny, this was dope, dude. I appreciate it.
Appreciate you.
Thanks,
man.
Bro. Yeah. Thanks.